Today I'm doing an update on the new NAFTA negotiations, a trade deal that's stuck on the one-yard line right now. And unfortunately, congressional leaders are rooting for defense. After looking at congressional negotiations, I'm calling pass interference on this one. So join us today as we explore the next step in the effort to pass this new trade deal. And yes, it has not been passed yet, a point Trump acknowledged in this 2019 State of the Union.
I hope you can pass the USMCA into law so that we can bring back our manufacturing jobs in even greater numbers.
Yeah, you and me both. Now, if you want to know the details of this plan, I did an episode all about it when the leaders from the United States, Mexico, and Canada all got together, shook hands, and accepted the deal 4 months ago. Since then, a third of the year has gone by, and members of Congress have just been poking this agreement with a stick and waiting for it to do something. Is it dead? No. Should we vote on it? Let's wait for the president to do something drastic to try to force our hand. Well, never fear, because your push to finally act could soon be coming, as not only is the president calling you guys out in his State of the Union address, but he's also threatening to pull America out of the NAFTA agreement. Which, like, yeah, I get that. We're going strong with this new relationship. Delete your ex's number from your phone, Congress. As of Thursday, Republican senators are a very hesitant group about committing to ending their old NAFTA relationship. Do we have a clip?
No!
Yeah, I kinda thought so. No one seems to care about this once all the leaders shook hands. Alright, so just to give you an idea of where we currently stand at this second, we're using the old NAFTA, also known as the worst trade deal ever signed in this country, because Congress is debating whether this new NAFTA is actually worse. By pulling out, which the president can unilaterally do under NAFTA's Article 2205, Trump will be removing any trade agreements between the United States and its neighbors until either Congress approves this new deal or we essentially have our own small-scale hard Brexit from North America and start this whole negotiating process all over again, this time with no trade deal in place. Oh no, Congress. Seriously, those bridges are burnt. We can't go back there again saying, yeah, we don't like this deal we pulled out of NAFTA and agreed to anymore. Give us more. So now to the question I'm suspecting is on everybody's mind, Congress, why do you hate this so much? Well, it's received bipartisan disapproval for exact opposite reasons. Republicans think it's not pro-trade enough, and Democrats don't think it goes far enough to protect the environment and workers. Wow, what a mess! So let's start with Republican dissent, being led by Pennsylvania Republican and member of the Senate Finance Committee, Pat Toomey.
In my view, the agreement that the administration has negotiated is frankly not really as good as the underlying NAFTA, the original NAFTA. But it's not terrible, and with a few tweaks that move it in the direction of a more pro-trade agreement, then it's something I could support.
Well, that sounds optimistic. A few tweaks. Or as he said more recently, he couldn't support the new trade deal without significant changes in the legislation. His problems with the legislation is that, well, it's not old NAFTA. The first one was better than the sequel. He consistently cites in his example the fact that this deal imposes a new higher minimum wage on auto workers in Mexico to make American workers more price competitive. Now, I know what you think of Republicans and trade. You probably think it's all let's tariff imports and go after other countries so they'll buy more of our things. But Toomey and plenty of other Republicans are your classic pre-Trump old school free traders who say things like,
I think the biggest changes are actually changes that diminish the free trade that NAFTA has permitted. I don't like the sunset provision that is in this. I don't like the dramatic reduction in the access to an investor state dispute settlement mechanism. I don't like the government mandating wage rates and putting quotas on imported vehicles. So it seems to me it's a modest step backwards from the point of view of a free trader.
Wow, tell me what you really think. So it basically wants to remove or pare down everything that made this treaty different from the old one. Great. At the same time, most of the Republican free traders, specifically Pennsylvania Republican Senator Pat Toomey and Wisconsin Republican Senator Ron Johnson, are leading a push to eliminate the steel and aluminum tariffs on Canada and Mexico, because we were using them in part as leverage to get new NAFTA. Yeah, as a guy who doesn't own a car factory or a steel mill, I definitely filed those tariffs under. Surely we've already done that, right? Well, we haven't gotten rid of them yet. The new trade deal includes removing those tariffs, but since we might have a full border wall before we figure this out, the tariffs might be there for a while, unless someone does something. These steel tariffs are hurting auto manufacturing in both of their states, and since they don't see any end in sight for this now civil trade war, they want unilateral action to apply to certain pieces of the treaty. As of Wednesday, Mr. Trump has refused to budge on these metal tariffs and instead threatened to withdraw from the old NAFTA to try to force Congress to vote on the new trade deal. Can't wait to see how that one plays out. So now let's go to the other side of the aisle, who recently wrote a letter of dissent to the president about this new NAFTA deal. Clip?
No! No! No!
Okay, geez, calm down. Democrats have said they cannot support this, mainly because it would greatly benefit pharmaceutical companies, but also because they want to push for more worker protections that would keep jobs in the United States and improve worker conditions. First, what's up with this pharmaceutical issue? Well, it's a bit odd because the main thing this would do is port a little bit of our messed up drug problem into Canadian and Mexican healthcare systems. In Mexico, biological drugs are patent protected for 5 years. In Canada, they're protected for 8. And in America, they're protected for 12. Because you can't do anything in this town without Big Pharma giving you the nod. This agreement standardizes protections to at least 10 years. Now, this is controversial because that's the period pharmaceutical companies can charge what they want without competition on the original drug creations. Because of this, Mexico's protection period just got doubled from 5 years to 10 years. Canada's protection period just gained 2 years from 8 years to 10 years. And America? Well, we actually have a little bit of wiggle room still because we're 2 years over that minimum.
Of course, it is bad news for Canada's generic industry to see exclusivity periods lengthened. And in the long run, and this is down the road a bit, but in the long run, you could see higher drug costs. And of course, we know that impacts government's bottom lines and costs for patients.
So not to be a selfish guy, but as an American, why should I care? I mean, with my knowledge of how much better their healthcare system is, it just gives me a slight sick sense of satisfaction knowing that America helped make it a little worse. We can't get to you, but we can certainly drag you down to us. The American objection here is that if Congress ever wants to lower the protection period below 10 years, they won't be able to without a three-nation summit. Democrats also want additional protections from outsourcing, environmental degradation, and workers' rights and freedoms. Basically, they looked at all of the Republican objections and thought, well, let's really lean into that. Although, maybe you guys could agree on drug protection periods. The question now is, what's next? Looking at the way this is going in Congress, Canadian Foreign Minister Chrystia Freeland on Wednesday shut down the idea of reopening negotiations. Specifically, she said that, as far as the new NAFTA is concerned, Canada has done its part. Oh God, China, I hope you're not watching this. If we finally get that deal with you guys, I'm sure it'll go a lot faster because not every senator will have their own opinion on that one. As far as the future, I'm not sure. But I can say that, as of 2 days ago, it was reported that both Democrats and Republicans said that this has little chance of passing without significant, and in this case, opposite changes. So Canada and Mexico, sorry for wasting all that time and tariff money, but it seems like for now we're just going to stick with the old NAFTA because of Congress. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.